The 50s was like the opening act of a play.
The 50s were an innocent, sweet time.
One of our concerns was what was going to happen, you know, like if a bomb would hit.
We would go eat at
Wimpy's Hamburger Stand.
I remember the 60s as being a time of political activism and social frivolity.
It just seemed like the world was not spinning on its axis right anymore.
The 60s were wonderful.
Oh, the 67 blizzard. Oh, boy.
I mean, I just feel real, real fortunate to have grown up in the 1960s and listening to Chicago radio.
That's not really the moon. These people aren't really landing on the moon.
White people have never been with black people. Black people have never been with white people.
We watched Garfield Goose with Beauregard the dog.
It was a great time to grow up.
In Morton Grove.
On the north side.
On the southwest side. Brunsfield.
West Rogers Park.
On the far northwest side of the city. And at that time, it really seemed to be the end of the city because beyond where we lived, there was nothing.
We lived in a two-flat house on a corner right across the street from a big, huge church. And four doors down was my grandmother's house with a four-flat, and all the rest of my aunts and uncles and cousins lived there.
We lived on 51st above my parents' restaurant.
It's probably unusual for most people to hear this, but I've lived in this house my whole life.
One-story ranch house, and my dad had it built with a VA loan.
On our block alone.
There were city workers. A lot of them were people that had a connection. School teachers, postal workers. And gangsters.
Being in restaurant business, we kids just got up out of the bed, got ourselves dressed, and we came down and sat in the booth and ordered breakfast.
There were 25 or 30 kids of approximately the same age, and you could easily find friends to play with.
People sat on their porch, you played with your girlfriends, no one called each other on the telephone, someone would come in front of your house and go, "Yo, Laura," and you'd come out and play.
I remember, go out and play, go out and play. Go outside, get some fresh air.
My brothers and I would go over here to the north branch of the Chicago River, make a raft from an old door and tie a chair on it, or use an old cement tub.
We had a swing set in our backyard. We had a little inflatable pool. That was the kind of stuff, yeah, that we did.
We knew that the boat would be there when we came back. How did we know this? Because it was always in a special spot under the bushes. But no one ever told their parents.
I remember freezing cold winters and, you know, ice skating in the park across the street. They would make this ice skating rink every year.
On Saturday afternoon, you had to go to the movies. And for a quarter, you could see three movies plus cartoons.
Oh, dear.
And we would walk. It seemed six or seven blocks to the Uptown and the Riviera, and we would eat popcorn all afternoon, and everybody had their special candy.
For most, the kids would kind of hang in their neighborhood, which would be a, you know, maybe an 8 or 9 block area.
We'd sit on the porch, we'd watch the cars go by, we'd watch people walk by.
Being the children of restaurant owners, we played restaurants.
We'd watch the bikes go by.
The Stingray bike was the big ticket, and every kid wanted a Schwinn Stingray.
We'd ride down Sheridan Road all the way to Winnetka.
Hopscotch, bouncing balls, jacks.
There was a funeral home on the block, so if a guy wanted to join the clique, he had to run into the funeral home and stay there for 5 minutes. We would time him, and he had to stand next to a casket. Oh boy, that was scary.
We did a lot of camping, if you will, in our small little 40 by 140 foot lots in the backyard.
No adult was there, and yet we learned how to play fair, and we learned the rules of the playground.
The buildings were very close in Chicago, and we would do what's called spider climbing, which was climb up
between two buildings. I had the best treehouse. It was a four-story treehouse, and we kept on building on top of it. I was a general contractor of treehouses.
We'd climb mulberry trees, pick the berries and eat them.
There were a lot of big trees all over the neighborhood, and there were fireflies in the front yard, and you could catch them at night.
In little bottles, and you know, see who could get the most in their jar, and who would have the brightest, and then we'd use them as like little like night lights and things like that.
There was so much freedom that nowadays it would probably be considered dangerous.
There was no fear, so it was cutting down the alley, go through the backyard, go walking down the alley. My mother would give me 45 cents to get, you know, milk and a loaf of bread and a pack of Pall Mall cigarettes.
One thing I really like about Chicago, it has alleys. And it has lit alleys and clean alleys.
The alley was sort of where kids hung out.
Kids would play baseball back there. Kids would hide back there.
We had a fruit and vegetable vendor named Joe. And Ross and I would run to the balcony of the back stairs, and we'd lean over and we'd yell at him, "Joe Schmo, big fat hoe." And of course, hoe had nothing to do with the way it's used today. We were little kids, we couldn't think of a better rhyme. And then he'd get mad, he'd pretend to get mad, and he'd yell in his Italian accent, "Hey, you kids, yelling at Joe, how can you yell at Joe?"
Well, you had watermelon men, and they would call watermelon, watermelon, sweet watermelon, dollar, dollar and a quarter, dollar and a half.
The peanut man, and he had a shrill whistle that went, "Ee!" You could hear it blocks away.
We had a peddler, his name was Chauncey, and he came with a truck. And when he came, we all ran to the truck, and he would always give us a piece of fruit to eat. And if he didn't, we'd take one anyhow.
I also remember the scissor grinder. He had a bell that went clang, 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 because he had it somehow connected to the wheels of his cart.
And he came about once a week. He had a horse and cart. And the horse was very gentle, and he wore a hat with his ears poking through the hat.
They'd jump down from the trunk and cut a plug, and you'd taste it, and, you know, he'd bring it up to your back door.
And, it, you know, he missed a day, you know, or missed a week. You'd worry about the man.
We love Joe.
One day, he just never came back, and that part of life was over.
The mothers were everywhere.
So it was hard to get in too much trouble.
It was like a union of mothers, all right? And they were really strong.
If you did something at one end of the block, by the time you got to the other end of the block, your parents knew if it was not something good.
If we snuck over to go to like grocer land and like to buy baseball cards or something, somehow, like when we got home, our mom would say, "Why are you buying baseball cards? How much money do you have in your pocket? You don't have any money. I didn't give you any money when you left." And they just knew all this about us.
We just played a lot, you know, so, and then we had to be home in time for dinner because we always ate dinner together as a family.
Most of the things that we did was orientated around family type of things. My dad woke up every morning at 6:30, woke us all up, the kids. Then we would get up, go to school. Every Saturday we had hamburgers on the grill. We went to church every Sunday.
All of our activity, our social life, you know, our friendships, they all started with the parish. And for a long time, if you met anyone from Chicago and you said, "Where are you from?" they'd say,
"St. Barnabas Parish, John Fisher Parish,
St. John of God,
Our Lady of Peace,
St. Cajetan's Parish, St. Walter's Parish."
You were identified by the Catholic parish that you lived in.
There was, of course, a lot of pomp and circumstance surrounding the church. So we had processions and we had high masses and, you know, of course, communions. Every year some class made their communion, so that was always a big event.
And May crowning, that was a big, big thing. May was Mary's month, and we had this big procession
around the block and around the school and into the, you know, to the big cathedral, and those rites and rituals were pretty beautiful.
In the Catholic schools, you were disciplined, you know. We were taught to be perfect little mannered children, you know, so it was quite different when you didn't see the same thing in the public school.
I went to Rogers elementary school. And every single kid in the class had a Jewish last name, the Goldbergs, the Rosenbaums.
We went to Catholic school because we were Catholic. And the public school kids, they were just public school kids. And in our neighborhood, they were a little rougher, a little more rough and tumble than the Catholic school kids.
Oh, they were enemies. We had no contact with Catholic school kids at all. We became aware of them, really, when we became older and saw them all on bandstand trying to cover up their Catholic school uniforms with sweaters.
We had a public school very close to us, and all the students would walk by our house every day, and it was like they were different. What were you like? Where are you from? Can we talk to you? Are you normal? Because we only know the people from the Catholics.
They were like aliens to us. Everything about them, you know, Jesus, the Virgin Mary, the bleeding hearts, the church, it was like alien.
They were rather mysterious or different. They had to eat fish on Friday.
Catholic boys were the forbidden fruit. Any Christian, but especially Catholic.
And there was a difference. You're almost scared to talk to them. You have to go to confession or something if you did.
And of course, any other religion such as Hindus or Muslims, I mean, they weren't even like thought of because we never saw any. They just were not part of our world.
When it comes to crackerjack, some kids never grow up.
The original Dove ice cream store was on 6000 South Pulaski. And they started making those ice cream bars by cutting pints of ice cream into four squares, sticking in a stick and asking you what you wanted it dipped in.
We used to go to the Rainbow Cone.
Rainbow Cone was like a treat in the summertime because it was only opened in the summer. It was like slabs that looked round, but they were really a slab of a different flavor. And what was amazing flavor was pistachio, very exotic.
And Cock Robin had their famous sherbet. They had the orange on the top, the green in the middle, and the lemon to cleanse your palate at the end.
We would go to a place called Buffalo.
Buffalo Ice Cream Parlor was at Irving and Pulaski. And that would be the place where you would end up with your friends or with your folks or on a birthday to go and have wonderful ice cream creations.
Oh, the Good Humor Man, life stopped, including dinner, when you heard the Good Humor Man bells. And I remember toasted coconut.
Toasted almond. We weren't allowed to buy from Good Humor. And so my mom, and this is another thing about the Amalgamated Union of Mothers, okay? They would like tell the Good Humor Man, don't come down our street.
I remember the Good Humor Man coming through the neighborhood, and once out of every three or four times we were allowed to get ice cream. It wasn't a constant where nowadays any child can get anything they want. No, not when I grew up. He would know, you know, he would know who the big houses were. He'd sit there and ring the bell until somebody broke down and came out with some money. But my neighbors would always get something all the time. They'd always have that chocolate or something stuck to their mouths and want to go play after we sat on our stoop with our arms folded looking at our parents.
I want my Nampa! Birthday parties when I was a kid were lots of fun. They were at-home affairs.
We went to someone's basement.
It was your special day. You were queen for a day, you were princess for a day.
And we all wore our party dresses.
Most of the kids always dressed up for birthday parties, even though we played and got dirty.
You would wear little white ruffled socks, you would wear patent leather shoes.
Crinolines and little ankle socks and yeah, Peter Pan collars.
A lot of times you had a theme.
It was either a cowboy and Indian party, which I had when I was eight.
A splash party. One year we had a Riverview party.
There would always be little place settings, and in each place setting you would have your own hat, your own whistle, and your own special birthday dessert cup.
We always had a cake and we always had the candles. And the wishes you got on your birthday cake with the candle Those were really important wishes, and those are the ones that came true. Later on, we used to play pin the tail on the donkey.
You'd play telephone, and someone would whisper that little phrase in your ear, and it would go all around the table. Musical chairs was a huge one. Oh, London Bridge is falling down, falling down. Hot potato, duck, duck, goose, where you'd all sit around the circle. And also red light, green light. That was a great game to play.
And then you'd go home at a certain time. Our family had a cowbell that was rung when it was time to come in. My mom would ring the cowbell out the door, and it had a deep sound. And gradually, other people in the neighborhood would start using bells, but they all had different sounds. So you could tell if it was your bell ringing or not.
You were kind of expected to go fill your time and get out of the house, and that's what you did. You know, a lot of running around. You know, you'd come home if you wanted something to eat, or you'd just as likely go to somebody else's house and have a sandwich. Everybody was in and out of each other's houses. Doors were unlocked, doors were open.
But everyone knew, the whole neighborhood knew, when the streetlights come on, you have to go home.
When the streetlights go on, come in.
And the streetlights would kind of flicker and come on, and the kids would say, I have to go.
When the lights went on, you went in.
The thing about the lights is that they were the old lights, like you see in movies. There would be a pool of light, and then dark. And there'd be a pool of light, and then dark. It was a very charming time.
Charlie says, love my good and plenty. Charlie says, really rings the bell. Charlie says, love my good and plenty. Don't know any other penny that I love so well.
My mother owned and ran little delicatessen. It was called Marie's Delicatessen. You know, sold milk and cold cuts and bread and penny candy.
And it was just a big treat because there was a big glass case and everything in there was a penny.
Penny candy is like what they sell now for a quarter.
Most people didn't have any money, okay? So how we got our money to buy our candy was we collected pop bottles. We got 2 cents for regular pop bottles and 5 cents for the big ones.
You could take a quarter and come out with a whole bag of candy. And it looked like it would seem such a big bag. It would be a little brown bag.
You had Red Hot.
And you'd have Smarties, you'd have Mary Janes.
The dots on the white paper and the Twizzlers and the Lick-A-Made.
One time I ate so much Lick-A-Made, my mouth just blew up.
Or the lipstick, or the little bottles of Coke that were filled with syrupy water.
They'd have them in all of these little containers that, you know, the clear containers with the little silver tops. And that kind of even resembles some of the goldfish bowls. That's what they look like.
Wax mustaches, yeah, the wax teeth.
Or you would get the push-ups. Remember the push-ups?
I always thought everybody had a penny candy store, you know?
Every time I ding-dong-ding, come with me to play and sing. Ding-dong, ding-dong, ding.
We had a television early on, one of the first people in the neighborhood, period, who had a television. So all of my friends would be at our house watching Howdy Doody and Captain Video and the Video Rangers.
And of course, you know, there was no remote, so we were the channel changers. And that was always a good job.
And we started charging a penny. My mother didn't know it, but we would charge these guys a penny so they could come in and watch.
The first TV we had was a TV that you paid for it by putting quarters in it. Okay? Instead of making monthly payments by the mail, you put quarters in this thing.
We were probably late to the TV game. You know, we were readers. We were supposed to be readers. TV was the evil empire coming into your home.
On Saturday, we would get to eat a TV dinner at noontime. I would have a turkey TV dinner, and I would watch The Lone Ranger and Tonto.
Every week, I waited to see what songs made the hit parade.
You watched Leave It to Beaver, okay, even though they were calling me Eddie Haskell.
Romper Room was definitely one that we watched, and you'd always listen for your name at the end when she talked about the, you know, in the mirror, and I see so and so and so and so.
It's a thing! It's a plane! It's Superman!
Superman, oh, wow. Wow, I love that program.
I lived close to the school, so you could come home for lunch if you lived within a certain distance, so we'd come home and eat lunch and watch lunchtime little theater.
We'd take our mother's aprons, you know, and put them, make them as capes, and we'd wear long underwear, and... But, I mean, I thought I was Superman.
Kukla, Fran, and Allie.
Rather than that, I used to like to watch the Mickey Mouse Club with Spin and Marty. You know, their little soap operas on the show.
And the grown-ups would say, M-I-C, see you real soon. K-E-Y. Why? Because we like you. Not love you. Like you. M-O-U-S-E.
We watch Ray Rayner, of course.
Captain Kangaroo.
Family classics. Garfield Goose. Garfield Goose was a big one with me.
We used to call him Goose Garfield. We never called it Garfield Goose. I don't know why.
We watched Garfield Goose with Beauregard the dog. I forgot about all about Garfield Goose, yes. I would love to see some of those reruns.
$1 million idea. He's had another $1 million idea.
Clutch Cargo and his pals Spinner and Paddlefoot.
Bozo the Clown, of course, was the local television show that all the kids watched.
My dream was to be on Bozo.
There was like a 5-year waiting list to get on Bozo the Clown.
And my parents got tickets.
Being on Bozo Circus was the coolest thing.
That was the bomb. I mean, I was so psyched up.
I was Wizzo the Wizard on the Bozo show for 26 years.
I danced on Bozo, and I got to meet Bozo and Ringmaster Ned.
One time I walked over to somebody and went, doody, 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 roll my eyes, and people laughed, and they said, keep that in, that's very funny.
That was the first time I was ever on TV, and seeing all what's the other side, you know, because you kind of have the feeling when you're watching it that there's this circus going on, you know, and you're just watching this whole circus, and then you get down there and you see the back side of what you don't see on TV, and that was just like an amazing shock.
We got to go to Bozo's Circus. And so I got to sit on Mr. Ned's lap and introduce the cartoon for Rocky Squirrel. That was a highlight.
I love the grand prize game.
We're 6 buckets, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And you get a ping pong ball and you throw it in bucket number 1 and you win something.
What my father did was he got me buckets and we practiced, you know, with those white balls.
Throw it in bucket number 2, you win something else.
We practiced and practiced.
And each prize is better as you go up to bucket number 6.
And practice.
Once in a while, a kid would miss at bucket number 3, and he'd only get what he got in the first few buckets.
By the time I got on to Bozo, I was like all pro before I even started.
You'd get $50 in a bucket and a Schwinn bicycle on bucket number 6.
When you saw that arrow going through the stands, and all of a sudden, it picked you. Boy, oh boy. That was Nirvana. And I got chosen. I got chosen. It was unbelievable.
When that was live, the show was live, guys were sitting in bars, and they'd see a kid come up. They, oh, that kid, I'll bet you $2 he makes it to bucket 3 or 4 or 6.
So as I kept on putting the ball into the buckets, I would jump, and I'll never forget, Bozo kept on trying to calm me down a little bit because I'd be jumping and moving my hands.
And even the guys in the control room were betting on, this kid looks like he's really going to make it to 6.
Once I hit the 6, I went ballistic. I started jumping up in the air. I mean, I was just overwhelmed with happiness. You know how people come over here, foreigners come over and say, only in America, okay? It was only on Bozo in Chicago, baby.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and for you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. shades of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying, I love you. I hear babies cry, I watch them grow. They'll learn much more than I'll ever know. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Yes, I think to myself, what a wonderful world.